You are listening to the Bomb Hole.
Bomb Hole Podcast.
It's going to be very hot. It's going to be very uncomfortable for everybody.
The Bomb Hole.
You're going to slide down them big hills. You know what I mean? On the big, nice, burgundy snowboard.
Okay, we are back in the booth for another episode of the Bomb Hole presented by Pub Beer, Solomon, and Wild Mike's Ultimate Pizza. Now, Stony Buds, how are we doing today?
So good this morning.
Love that. Rezzy's looking pretty tall. Beanie's looking good. And to my left, we have Stefi Luxton from New Zealand. Stefi, what's going on?
Not much. Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here today.
Yeah, Steffi's our first guest to actually walk here. She walked here with the snowboard.
All the way from New Zealand.
Yep, walked here all the way from New Zealand. No, I'm currently Carlos in Salt Lake City, so just decided to walk over.
With your board, here. Too.
Yep, board That's in awesome. My hand.
What is it, like 8:30 in the morning, just in streetwear, walking with a snowboard? People are like, what the hell?
It's probably not that out of order for Salt Lake City.
True. Yeah, I felt pretty comfortable.
So, first question I have for you, and I think it's an important one, is who are Julio and Jane?
Well, Julio was my car that I had for maybe like 3 or 4 years, and Jane Honda is my new car. I always name my cars just because, you know, it's like you spend a lot of time in them, you know, they deserve a name, so... Yep, Julio was my first car in America. Jane's my second.
Jane Honda, inspired by Jane Fonda?
Yes, very much so.
That's a great one. How did you get to Julio?
Julio, I bought off this like old Mexican guy that took really good care of this car, and he left the CD in it that was like this a Mexican music that I kept in it for its whole life. And I just decided Julio was...
It kind of flows off the tongue.
Yeah, great name.
Yep.
It's really one of Scott Blum, her significant other's footnotes, she said was that she's got an incredible knack for naming cars.
Really?
We named Scott's van Rick.
Rick.
Yep.
That's a great name for a van. Creepy dude name.
Yeah, it's kind of like it's like one of those vans without any windows in it. So, you know, Rick.
Rick.
It's Rick.
Let's give an air horn to Rick, Julio, and Jane Honda.
You kind of got to use Jane's full name, huh?
Yeah.
Jane Honda.
Yeah,
get the full flair.
You know, most people don't like catch on to it until like they actually think about it, but I actually stole that name off another girl in Mammoth. I didn't come up with it myself.
There's other people naming their cars out there. Huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. My parents named their car. Like, every car of ours was named.
Really?
No matter what, yeah.
Any notables of your parents?
Big Red, Black Betty.
Black Betty is a good one. Classic name.
My mom actually drives Black Betty right now, and my dad made this sticker for her to put on the side of it, and he, like... He doesn't know much about, like, the internet or like, how cheap you can get things. And I'm pretty sure he got, like, this sticker, and it cost him, like, $70 for this one sticker. But, yeah, it's still on there.
Well, let's throw it back to growing up in New Zealand, Wanaka area, correct?
Yes, I grew up in Wanaka. It was a pretty special place to grow up, you know. It's, like, absolutely amazing there, mountains and lakes and... I grew up, with a bunch of awesome friends, and my parents were, like, really supportive my whole entire life and still are, and, yeah, I miss it so much, but it's,
So you have two brothers, right? You're in the middle.
Yep.
And I think from what you were telling me, you kind of grew up in a boarding family.
Yeah, so I started snowboarding and skateboarding when I was 14, but my younger and older brother both skated and snowboarded like well before me, and my best friend growing up was his name was Beach, and he was like an incredible skateboarder as well, and so like, and he was really good friends with both my brothers, so like being around all of them, I was like, I want to start skateboarding, I want to start snowboarding, so I kind of just got into it at 14 and became absolutely obsessed with it, and I haven't really like looked back since. But both my brothers were huge inspirations towards like more so skateboarding than snowboarding, but snowboarding as well.
And then your younger brother, I was in a wormhole watching his video parts. This guy's unbelievably good.
Really?
He's a pro skateboarder.
Yeah. Yeah, my younger brother, Digby, he just went pro, like, during like, the lockdown quarantine, actually. He like, had a surprise, like, Zoom call with, like, the board sponsor that called Zen, which sponsors him, and, yeah, they made him boards, and my older brother designed the boards, and, like, he had no idea. It was pretty cool, and, like, went pro during that and released a part. He's released a couple of parts, actually, but, yeah, he's really good at skating.
We'll cue those up in the show notes.
Yeah, you definitely should.
What's up with his board graphic?
He's got, so his first two, I'm not sure what they are now, but his first two, he got two made. The first one is an aeroplane and, like, New Zealand, and he lives in Australia now, so the aeroplane is, he was born on an aeroplane, actually. On a 6-seater Cessna.
Your mom gave birth on a Cessna.
Yep.
Give her an air horn for that.
Yeah, she had, like, something go on with, like, pregnancy where they had to, like, rush her to hospital, and he was the third one being born, so I think he just, like, popped out real quick, and then, like, there was some crazy complications after he got, like, hypothermia and had to go, like, into the incubator and whatnot, but made it through. And yeah,
who actually delivered the baby?
There was a doctor on the airplane.
There happened to be a doctor.
Yep. And my granddad actually was born on a boat as well. He was on a boat from like, England to New Zealand. It was, like, the fourth, I don't know what boat it was, but yeah, he was, like, moving to New Zealand, and his mum died on the boat. I mean, yeah, his mum died on the boat, so he was, like, this orphan on a boat on the way to New Zealand, and just, like, arrived in New Zealand as this orphan baby. It's a pretty crazy story.
Horrible.
That's a crazy story.
Yeah.
Really crazy. His mom died while giving birth.
Yeah, because that was, like, back in the day, that was, like, I mean, I guess it was way more common for people to pass away. So, yeah, he was, like, this orphan that went to New Zealand, and I think his brother, his cousin, like, so my granddad's uncle, like, ended up taking care of him, I'm pretty sure.
Because otherwise it's just this baby arriving on the shore.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it was. I think he was in some, like, orphanage, he was an orphan for a while, yeah.
Wow, that's a crazy story. When I think of New Zealand, I just think of people growing up living in the sides of the mountain, kind of like a Hobbit scenario.
That's where they filmed The Hobbit.
I just think that that's what their life must have been like as a young kid growing up in a magical place where there's more sheep than people. And
exactly. I mean, it kind of is like that, to be honest.
It is.
Yeah.
Kind of that vibe.
Yeah.
Huh?
No matter where you go, it's, like, it's gorgeous. It's beautiful. It's such a beautiful country. Yeah. I'd
love to go there.
Yeah.
I remember we were there, just a side note, with 32 team years ago, and we were eating lamb when we were there, and common meal. There's a lot of sheep, and
there's, like, 40 million sheep or something.
Yeah,
like 7 million people, maybe less than 7 million.
Wow.
And we brought the fact to Joe Sexton that, you know, that was what we're eating. He's like, dude, you can't eat those. He's like, dude, what have you been having for dinner this whole, like,
he'd been eating it the whole trip
because they have the shank that's really good.
Yeah, the lamb shank.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Really, I don't really like lamb, though. I'm not a huge fan.
Either.
Yeah, not the like the taste of it.
Not that down.
Do you take offense? I know the Australians call the New Zealanders sheep fuckers. Have you ever heard that?
Yes.
Do you take offense to that term?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. It's just classic Aussies, you know.
Yeah, there's
some sheep fuckers over there. Because you see these specials on TV about towns where that kind of stuff goes on. And
oh, yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, there's weird people out there in the world.
there's shit that goes down.
Well, I think we should test your New Zealand street cred. Because I got some terms here. I'm going to see what you know. First term, chili bin.
Cooler.
Chili bin's a cooler.
Yep.
Chili bin, okay.
Okay, what's the dairy?
It's like the, like, local, like, little supermarket. Like, it's not a supermarket. It's, like, smaller than that. Convenience store.
Okay, what are jandals?
Sandals, but not, like, the slide-on sandals. They're, like, the ones that go in between your big toe and
like a flip-flop.
Yeah, flip-flops.
Okay, what
she's jandals?
She's pretty good, yeah.
She's pretty good.
What are togs?
Like a bathing suit.
Okay, wow, she's sharp.
Yep, right. I am Kiwi.
Tog.
All right, next term, munted.
Like, how do I explain it? It's like sketchy, kind of like not in full tact, I guess. I don't know how to explain.
I have a lot more.
You should almost let me guess what it is.
Okay.
And then she can let us know if we're correct.
Okay, well, here we go. The next one is chook. C-H-O-O-K, chook.
Chook is another word for Chewbacca and also when you're chewing tobacco.
That's incorrect.
Chook? I don't even know what chook is.
Oh, wow, we got her on one. It's actually chicken.
Wait.
Chicken.
Oh, wait. You're saying it wrong.
Okay, how do you...
Chook.
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 Okay. So yeah. I'll give you the spelling so you know.
Okay.
Chook. Okay, what's a dunny?
A dunny. That's like a good friend, like a buddy. What up, Dun? What up, Dunny?
That's actually correct.
It's correct. Is it?
Yeah. I mean, well, not in rap. Not in Kiwi. Not in Kiwi. But what's the Kiwi term?
Dunny's like a toilet bathroom.
Oh, that's correct. Right. I actually think that Buds might have blown up the dunny this morning. Exploded the dunny. Okay. This is kind of a term. It's wop wops.
Wop wops.
You know what that means?
I think I heard that used in the last Drake song. Wop wop. No?
That's incorrect. There's not really an answer, so.
No, that wasn't an answer. Yeah. A wop wop. Wop wop. I don't. I'm out on this one.
You gotta say it in like a super Kiwi accent. Wop wop brew.
Wop wop brew. Is that another name for a burger?
No, it's like it's like out in the country, basically, like rural.
Rural. Wop wop.
That's correct.
Out in the wop wop.
That's actually correct.
My parents live in the wop wops.
So this one's interesting. It's hot chups.
Hot chups.
Hot chups.
Those are warm slippers in the morning.
Incorrect.
Hot chips.
That's correct. That's like literally
but you guys
hot
call them chups. Hot chups.
I mean, it's more like. When you just put the accent
and it's
in
really
there.
French fries, probably, right?
Yeah.
It's
yep.
crazy so how many words are for French fries.
Our friend Chip, would you pronounce it Chup if you're from New Zealand?
Yeah.
We'd start calling him Chup.
I'm going to start calling him Chup.
Hey, Chup.
Yeah, Chip. Chip.
What's going on there? Chop,
chop, chop, chop.
All right. Next one. We got lots of these, but we're going to keep going. We're going to keep going because this is fun for the whole family. We're on a, the word is tiki tour.
Tiki tour.
Tiki tour.
That's when you are out in the wop wop. Is that yeah. the world? Yeah. And you got your tiki torch, and you're just cruising around the wop wop.
That's kind of correct in some form.
Yeah. They're like halfway there.
Yeah.
It's like going on like a Sunday drive, going on a tiki tour. Tiki.
Tiki.
Yep.
Tiki out in the wop wop.
Yeah, exactly. Right. You know,
Buds takes a tiki tour on his way here a lot of times.
Sometimes, yeah, sometimes.
I take a lot of tiki tours driving around Salt Lake. I do not have my bearings.
I also walked here this morning. That's why I was 20 minutes late.
So, yeah, the Jaffa, J-A-F-A.
Jaffa.
Jaffa. Jaffa.
Jaffa. I feel like I've heard this one before. Maybe they use it in Australia, too? That's a type of car, maybe? No, I swear I've heard this one before. Jimmy Jaffa? Hoffa?
I think, I don't, incorrect. What do we got?
Well, so it's a Jaffa, and a Jaffa is like a type of like chocolate with like orange around it, but a Jaffa is also stands for just another fucking Aucklander, because Auckland is like the biggest city in New Zealand, and... There's a lot of Aucklanders, and so Jaffa, just another
That's the real use.
Yeah.
She's good.
She knows
good.
Her shit. She must be from there.
This is a good one. I like this figure speech. Had a big one on the terps. Had a big one on the terps.
That's having a really good day on the resort.
Incorrect. But close.
Is it? It's like having a good time while drinking.
That was
it's almost exactly
I was half
correct.
Right.
Yeah, you could be having a good one on the terps, and also like you're on the slopes, but you're drunk, so it kind of works.
Tarps.
Yeah, yeah, well, that's one for you.
This this is a great one. I liked. It's a piece of piss. It's a piece of piss.
It's a pizza piss.
Yeah, you gotta go. It's a piece of piss, bro.
It's a piece of piss.
You gotta put bro on the end of every single thing.
Oh, they say bro all the time.
They say bro all the time.
It's just like Australians say legend, they say bro.
Yeah, they also say legend a lot in New Zealand.
They do.
Ledge. It's abbreviate.
It's a piece of bro? Or what is
piss.
It?
It's a piece of piss.
It's a piece of piss.
It's a piece of piss.
It's a piece of shit.
Incorrect, but no? I like your answer.
A piece of piss. It's like oh, like that's easy. Piece of piss.
Damn it. I could have got that.
Okay.
You should start using that one, though. Piece of piss.
What about taking the piss?
That's when you eat shit.
It's when you give someone shit, actually. Like,
give someone shit.
Yeah, like.
But you're actually kind of almost correct in that.
I've been half right on a lot of these.
You're a Kiwi.
Okay, and then.
Where did you get all these from? These are like, you've got quite a few.
Serious internet research.
Yeah.
A lot of, it's a little secret website I like to use called Google.
Google.
Yeah.
My googly.
That old thing.
And then last one we'll hit for a minute is tramping.
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 That's a big day on the trampoline working on my air awareness.
I think that's correct.
Is it?
Not by New Zealand definition, but.
Tramping's like backpacking, like going on. Yeah.
Why is it called tramping?
I don't know. Because you're tramping over the friggin' mountains. Oh, like,
gotcha.
Yeah.
Tromping around, tramping.
Yep.
Stepping on things.
Yeah, stepping on things, going up and down mountains, you know, carrying a huge backpack, tramping. Well,
Are any of these come from like the UK too, or is it?
Oh just yeah, I think like a huge majority comes from.
Okay.
From like British.
Well, I'll tell you what, Steffi, I think you did phenomenal on the quiz.
Yeah, she's definitely a local to her country.
New Zealand quiz.
Yep, missed that place.
So I heard you had an interesting kind of road to America from New Zealand.
I did have a very interesting road to America. So I have a green card, which I won in the lottery. So in America, there's a lottery system that is set up every single year, and you can apply. It's like in like October or something. So you apply. It's like open for 1 month. They don't have it open all year because like way too many people would apply. And so I like randomly applied one night, like 2013. I was like at my friend's parents' house, like having dinner or something, and they're American, and they were like, oh, we'll help you apply, because there's so many websites that are like confusing, and it's like scams and like people trying to make you pay and whatnot, but like it's actually like free to apply. So they like helped me like figure it all out and go like to the government websites and like apply, and I applied and like kind of forgot about it, and then and this was 2013, so I was competing a lot and like coming back and forth from America back to New Zealand, and I was on a extended visitor's visa, and which was fine, because I wasn't like making any money in America or anything. I was like making all my money in New Zealand, and that's how I was able to like come in and out of America pretty easily. And I thought it was fine traveling on this extended visitor's visa, and then like 2000 and I'll go back. So 6 months later, after I applied for this lottery, I got like another notice being like, congratulations, you've made it to like the second round. And I think it's like 160,000 people make it to the second round. And out of like millions of people that apply, like anyone pretty much in the world can apply for this visa. And I was like, whoa, that's kind of crazy. So I like filled out all the paperwork online and kind of like forgot about it again, like, and just like carried on, was competing, pretty busy with all that kind of stuff. And then 2015, I was coming back into America, and they like stopped me at the border and were like, you're like spending way too much time in America. Like, you're not allowed to be in the States for over 6 months a year. And I thought like I was allowed to like come in and like I would leave to Europe to compete and come back, and my 6 months would get extended. And that's how it worked for like a huge portion of my competitive career. And one time at the border, like, was like this angry like customs lady, or I can't even remember who it was. And I guess, like, you're only allowed to be in the States for 6 months, and then you have to, like, be gone for 6 months. Like, that's all you're allowed. Like, I wasn't allowed to, like, be here for 8 months, even if I was leaving to go to Europe or New Zealand or whatever. And so I got red flagged at the border, and they let me in for 6 months, but I had to get a visa. And this was, like, I had, like, filled out the stuff on my lottery stuff, but, like, wasn't even thinking about that. Like, that wasn't even crossing my mind, and I was, like, shit, I have to buy an athlete visa, and in order to, like, be able to, like, stay in America and compete. I was still, like, somewhat competing at the time. And so I, like, this was the year that I moved to Mammoth, actually, with Possum, and I was really poor. Like, I hardly had any money, and I was like, I had to, my friend's athlete lawyer, so she, like, hooked me up a little bit on getting the athlete visa, but I bought the athlete visa, and, like, so I was good to go for 3 years, which was, like, a process in itself, because the athlete visa, you need like paying American sponsors and contracts in order to get it. And so I had to, like, go through all these loopholes to, like, I was, like, riding for Ride, but I had no contract with them, but, like, Tanner, like, sent me a letter and, like, pretended like he paid me, and Bridges, like, sent me a letter. Like, you have to, like, go through this huge process of getting this athlete visa that was, like, it ended up being for no reason at all, because, like, right after the season of getting the athlete visa, I think it cost me, like, $3,500 for it, I, like, got a message in the mail, and it was from, like, these random people that I was living with in Carlsbad, and they were like, this, like, piece of mail came for you, and it looks important, we want to send it on to you. And I was like, okay. And I was living in Mammoth, and I got them to send it there, and it was like this, like, government like, document letter being like, congratulations, you've been accepted for, like, the interview process of your green card. And I was like, holy shit, like, wow. I was like, I'm almost there. Like, I kind of, like, had forgotten about it, because this is, like, 2015, so, and I applied 2 years ago.
Millions,
so it was, like,
of people apply.
Yeah, and so, like, it was, like, this two-year process, and I, like, did not expect to, like, be in the, like, even somewhat being able to get the green card. And so, yeah, I got the athlete visa, got this piece of information. I was like, I need to go back to New Zealand to go to this interview. And so I ended up going back to New Zealand and, like, working and, like, preparing for this interview, which I was so nervous about. And I, like, went into the New Zealand embassy, and, like, I was freaking out. I had to, like, get a bunch of, like, doctor's notes. In order to get, like, a green card, you have to, like, go to the doctor to make sure you're, like, healthy. You need, like, chest x-rays. You need, like, shots and stuff that they require, which is, like, flu shots and whatnot, and like, all your information of everything of your life, basically. And so I was, like, prepping for that back in New Zealand, and I, like, went into the embassy, and it literally, the interview took, like, 10 minutes, and they were like, congratulations, you got a green card. And I was like, damn. And this was, like, probably June, like, it was coming into winter in New Zealand. And then I was like, I don't want to go to winter in New Zealand this year. Like, I just had started dating Scott, and he was like, he was going to go on this road trip to go to Hood. And I was like, I'm going to come back to the States and, like, go snowboarding at Hood. I've never been there before. And he was like, yeah, we'll go on a road trip. And so, yeah, I got the green card, and, like, and they put, like, something in my passport. Like, I didn't actually have the physical green card yet. And, They put something in my passport, and I flew back to America, and that was, like, the start of, like, me actually living in America full time.
And only one person gets this?
No, I don't know how many.
A handful, maybe?
Yeah, like, wow. Like, Australian New Zealanders, it's, like, a bigger percentage of people that get it. It's, like, 10% compared to, like, the rest of the world, because they like us over
here.
Yeah,
yeah.
But yeah, no, I'm not sure the exact amount of people that get it, but yeah.
It's a rare thing.
It's pretty, it's really rare. Yeah. Like, it's like, I got so lucky with, like, timing and everything. And, like, it sucks that I, like, spent all that money on that athlete visa, but I would not throw it away for the world. Like, you know, the athlete visa was only three years or something like that. Like, it wasn't going to last forever. And
now you're an American citizen.
I'm not, I can become a citizen like this year if I want to, but I'm like a permanent resident right now. Cool. So I pretty much can do everything apart from vote. So I have like social security number and all that. Wow. And like getting my green card was crazy because I had lived in Mammoth the year before and I like didn't have an address in America. I didn't have like a PO box or anything. And I like hit up my landlord from the year before and was like, hey, can I get this piece of, this letter sent to you? And it was like, this was like my green card and my social security number. And she's like, yeah, of course. And like, I didn't tell her what it was. And she wasn't home at the time. And she's like, your letter came. And she's like, I hid it under the couch in the backyard, under the pillow of the couch in the backyard. And I remember like showing up to her house being like, I think this letter's like somewhere around here. And I was like searching under this couch, like outside, and like finally like got the piece of mail. And it was like, yeah, it was my green card and social security.
Man, that's incredible. I actually called me ignorant. I never realized how difficult it was to become, you know, I guess normally people marry to get a green card and stuff, but it's just that whole process.
Yeah, think about how many people want to become citizens, you know, from so many mm-hmm. different countries.
Yeah, I know. I like.
There's droves of them at the border. Yeah. Sent them all home, but now they're all trying to come back.
Yep. Yeah, I got, yeah, it's pretty crazy that's how it happened, but it was, and it was all like such insane timing as well, because like, 2015 was, well, it was like the end of 2014, which was like right after the Olympics. And that winter had, me and Possum had just been dropped from the New Zealand team. So it was like this kind of crazy like transition in our lives. And we were like, we don't want to go back to Colorado. We were spending a bunch of time in Colorado, like competing, just because it was like an easy city to like fly in and out of. We were on the road for a lot of the time. And we're like, we don't want to go back to Colorado at all. We want to like try something new. So we like moved to Mammoth and still there. We plan on being there for 3 months. And we're like, I think this is my 7th year there.
It'll suck you in, huh? Yeah. Those mountain towns.
We kind of breezed over it. We didn't really talk about it. But, you know, your competitive background, you know, you've done all the contests. You grew up doing Grand Prix. You're a damn Olympian. I know that's like kind of in the rear view now, but let's talk about that part of your life.
Yeah, that part of my life is like honestly a little bit of a blur. but yeah, I'm really grateful for all those opportunities that I got. Like I was on the New Zealand team, and that was why I was able to like travel. And
can we talk cheddar biscuits as far as national team? Because
yeah, do they pay?
I heard it's better than the sponsors in a lot of cases.
So the way the New Zealand team was set up when I was competing was you would earn grants through competitions. So like they would pay for my travel and whatnot, but they didn't like physically like pay me. I would earn it with competition results. So one year I like made pretty good. I like made like 40 grand in like one like grant that I received. But like that's 40 grand New Zealand. So like, and that was like when the New Zealand dollar sucked. So I'd like be in America, and it was like, yeah, I mean, it was still really good money, but.
What would you compare 40K?
Back then it was like 20.
20. Still good money.
Yeah, still right. Really good money. And like, that was how I was able to survive throughout my whole competitive career. I never had sponsors competing really, like not paying sponsors. And I remember, yeah, they would like set up the competitions to, they would make like one main competition per year, and I can't remember what they would call it, but you would, yeah, it would be like the comp where you could like, depending on what place you got, would be how much money you would make for the year.
Crazy.
And, like your ranking.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And it was all done in one contest.
One contest.
If you have a bad day, sorry.
Yeah, and I'm not sure if it's still like that now, but it was like they did it like that to like base it off the Olympics, I think. And so like, I don't know if it's like putting pressure on you in this competition to like perform or whatever, but yeah, the Olympics was like the competition of the year. Like that's where you'd, that was like my one competition that I made some money in. And before that it was like, you know, like it was like the world championships or something. But yeah, like going into the Olympics, I was, all I cared about was like earning that grant, because that grant is the way that I could keep snowboarding the next year. So like I wouldn't even like really think about the like I was never really good at, I sucked at competing, to be honest. Like, I was so bad. I was never really that competitive. I was just like, I was always like, yeah, I was not a very competitive person, but I just wanted to keep snowboarding every single year. So I would always just like really try hard in those competitions to land on my feet.
Yeah, because otherwise you're not going to have budget for exactly. Your next
season. Exactly. Otherwise I would have to like.
That was your whole drive.
Yeah, my whole drive was just like being able to continue to snowboard.
Yeah, you weren't like, I have to get this gold medal.
Most people, their whole thing's like, my whole life is building up to going to the Olympics. And you're like, I need to go to the Olympics so I can pay the fucking bills.
Trying to get 20K to shred.
So like, then go back and ride POW and just get your.
Yeah. But yeah, they're also like in the New Zealand team, they have like blocks of like, if they've got like a carding system, and it might be different now as well. Like, I mean, I haven't done it forever, but like, say Zoe right now, she's like top. So she's like level one carded. So when we were doing it, I was like always like the worst carding level. But they would like give you like, depending on where you were. So like in January, because it was like pretty heavy on the competitive, like that's when all the competitions were, they would give you like budget towards your rent and like budget towards your food. And I was so poor. I remember I used to like go to the supermarket and steal receipts out of the rubbish bins to like use as my invoice to like get money, because I didn't need like, I think they gave you like $125 a week or something, and I was like, if I spend like 60 on food and then like use this other like 60 then I'm making money. And
that's
I can,
a pro tip right
I
there
a, I got a pro tip for anyone that's in that situation. It's fakereceipt.com. They will actually, you can make any receipt you want for anything.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, and then, good to know, actually.
Boom, you got whatever you need.
Yeah. Yeah. I've never made money from snowboarding, that's for sure. But I've definitely figured out ways to, like, get around.
It's about
being
the passion,
to still
right?
being on the snowboard. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just about staying on the snow, really.
Yep.
It's all a means to an end.
Yeah. Scott was kind of saying that you are very comfortable with absolutely no plan. Like, you guys did a 60 day road trip going to a hood and surfed and everything, and you were just, like, totally chill.
Yeah. I hate plans, honestly. But yeah, like no plan, no problem is my outlook on life.
That's an awesome outlook.
I mean, it's a little bit different these days with like being a student, being a business owner and like things like that. But yeah, I really enjoy just like waking up and like getting the day to show you what, like, you know, if there's surf that day, go surfing, like not having I hate plans. And I think a big chunk of that stemmed from like being on the New Zealand team, honestly. Like, it was not, it was just like so, like all these people like worked around your, like you, and like, you know, they like set you up meetings and like all this like stuff that didn't even have anything to do with snowboarding. And I'm sorry for talking shit on the New Zealand team now, but like, yeah, like that, I don't know. I just like, it kind of like fried me out a little bit of snowboarding. And like, I don't know, my mentality has changed so much from my competitive days to now. And I think it was mostly from just like plans.
Yeah. It should burns you out.
You're like, we need you in this meeting.
Yeah.
Talking about this.
I'm like,
and
I don't
like,
need to be talking about
trying to snowboard.
Yeah. I'm like, I'm not coming down the mountain right now to be in this meeting. But yeah, they were like, they're very professional, I guess, with like, yeah, like, I mean, it's just, they have such a big team working for you, because you snowboard, which was always like a crazy concept to me. I'm like, so it's just snowboarding, you know, it's just like.
I think that's why some of these U.S. athletes are stoked they're not making money from the government to snowboard, because then otherwise then they'd have to be doing all that too.
Yeah.
So it kind of makes sense. They just, all these people have to quantify what's going on.
Yeah, for sure.
Do you feel like if. From what I understand with the national teams and stuff, it's like, go snowboarding with your coach and then do like box jumps in the gym. And is that kind of what you're talking about too? Like, they would make these whole like schedules and you got to do.
Yeah. Like, parts of the New Zealand team were sick. Like, we would travel around with like a physio, and like they would like work on your body every single night. But like, yeah. And like a trainer would travel with us. But, and so we would like be in the gym, you know, like, and during like a heavy like snowboard, I don't know how to even talk about it, but
it's interesting how important medals are to these countries too, you know. Like when you see the Chinese teams and the Russian teams and the stigma they got back in the day about how serious it was. And
yeah, and like the New Zealand team, when we were competing, that we like really needed to do well in order for them to get budget from the government again, and none of us did well. Like we got so much bad press.
So the people in charge of you are all stressed about their jobs. And,
yeah, 100%. And then, like, so it's so, so lucky for them now that they have, like, Zoe and, like, there's, like, this young skier kid that's, like, winning everything. And so they've probably got some, like, major. Yeah, they got some, like, major budget right now probably. But I think Zoe's medal was, like, the first medal in winter, their Winter Olympics for, like, since, like, 92 or something like that. Jeez. Like, yeah,
that's sick.
Yeah,
she just killed it at natural selection too. That was really
fun. Yeah, she's incredible.
So I kind of want to talk about your significant other for a second here, Scott Blum.
Yeah.
Now I have
a kind of snowboarding's bad boy.
He is. Now, who do you think has a higher level of patience, you or Gandhi dating Scott?
That was a great answer.
Me.
Love the pause that it took to get there.
Yeah, she's. I like the honesty on that answer because we all know that that's true. Part two of the question. So Scott Blum's been, he's been in town here for a bit, and he's been, the Magoons were just here. You know, Magoon family, shout out. Got to give him a quick little air horn.
Oh, yeah, I love that family.
And I've seen him around Winter Magoon, and he's like a real, he's got, you know, he's looking like he wants to be a dad now. Would you
turns
say
into a big softy, huh?
He seems like he's a kind of a bad boy. You see him around winter, his heart melts.
Yeah, his heart melts.
It seems to me, Steffi, that he looks like he's got baby fever. What do you think?
I don't know about baby fever. I feel like he more just like, I feel like he relates better to children, honestly, than adults. Like, he can, like, have conversation with children way easier than he can have conversation with adults. And, yeah, hopefully not baby fever, because I'm not ready for that yet.
So you're saying it's kind of like they have the same maturity level.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, that makes sense.
Like,
him and Winter are just having a full-on serious conversation.
Yeah, he can relate. He can relate to three-year-olds better than probably 30-year-olds, to be honest.
So going back to the comp stuff, I know that you had some crazy injuries throughout your career doing contests, right?
Yeah, I've had so many injuries. Ruptured my spleen, broke my collarbone a bunch of times. I've been in two wrist casts at once. I've like gashed my shin open, like so many injuries.
Let's go back to the rupture of the swing, because I ruptured my, I almost died when I ruptured mine, but did that happen to you when you?
Yep, yeah, almost died.
What happened?
I was hitting like this tiny little jump in Colorado, and I like over-rotated with my body, and I did like a front three over-rotated with my body and hooked my toe edge and like slammed down on my left side and ruptured my spleen, and I was like, it like didn't hurt too crazy at the time, but I was like, I was really tired. I remember like snowboarding down to the bottom of the mountain and like being like, I want to go to bed right now. Like I am tired. And that was just like my body dying basically.
Going septic, right? Basically.
Yeah. And my friends I was with, Possum and Shelly, they were like, you should just go to the medical center and like get it checked out. Like if the work, like nothing's gonna happen, like may as well. And I was like, okay, whatever. And I like walked over there, and I had like crazy pain in in my shoulder, and I really had to pee. And I like walked into the medical center, and I was like, can I please go to the bathroom? And so I like peed immediately, and I came out, and then told them my symptoms, and I immediately like got rushed to hospital and like put on, and I got a CAT scan, put on like really strict bed rest, like wasn't allowed to leave the bed for however many days, but luckily like kept the spleen in there, and so thankful to like still have my spleen, because that's just like a huge portion of your like immune function and keeps you healthy and whatnot.
You can survive without it?
Yeah, back in the day they used to take spleens
just out
of
it.
Yeah, that if you would even like somewhat rupture it, it would be like gone. And yeah,
they describe it like a bowl of jelly. So when you like tear, like well, you and I had the same thing. It's a laceration.
Yeah.
So it like tears open, and like all the it it purifies your blood. So all these toxins leak out into your bloodstream, basically poisons you from the inside out. And like blood goes into your diaphragm. There's all kinds of shit.
Doesn't it make you pee blood too?
I didn't pee blood. Yeah, no.
That happened to me either, but.
I don't know if that's a symptom or not.
But that is like pretty common with like organ injuries, but yeah. Not the spleen, I don't think.
And I guess if you hit it hard enough, it might just pop, huh? Like a grape.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, then, it can explode into a bunch of pieces. That's when people they pull that shit out.
Yeah. I feel like rupturing your spleen is pretty common in snowboarding, though. Mm-hmm. Like it's like.
If you fall in the right spot, yeah, it's going to rupture.
It's like your ribs aren't quite there to protect it.
Mine actually burst on an airplane.
Really?
I fell at Big Bear and then elbowed myself in the gut. And I was like, I had a little stomach ache and then went to the airport actually the next morning. And as we were going up to altitude, I just felt something inside me burst. And
you felt it.
I felt it. And I thought it was like a kidney. And I'm like, all right, I'll be all right. I'm going to make it home. And I was in the plane. And I was like, holy shit. Like it was, you know, luckily Big Bear to Salt Lake's only a couple hours. So like towards the end of the flight, I was like, I don't know what's wrong with me. I think I'm fucked up. And then we kind of like landed and I told my buddy Doman, shouts to Doman. He was there at the airport. I'm like curled up in the back of his van. I'm like, drive me to the ER. I'm going to fucking
remember hearing about
I'm going to die, dude. I was like, I'm going to die. Drive as fast as you can to the ER. I don't know what's wrong with me. And so we got there and seemed like 4 days in the ICU. And doctor was like, if your flight was an hour longer, you would have died on the plane. That's what they told
me.
But it's like one of those things where you got to get to the hospital. Like
quick. You almost should have flagged someone down at the airport.
Yeah, but I was basically. Like, I don't know. It's just a stomach ache. Like I thought I might just have diarrhea. My shoulder hurt, like you said.
Yeah, yeah. That's like
weird.
If you
that's
rupture,
a symptom.
If you rupture your spleen, you always have like pain in your shoulder. Which
I thought
which
that
is,
was from your fall.
Nah, it's a symptom from the spleen.
I wonder why that makes your shoulder hurt.
Yeah, I don't know.
One injury you were telling me particularly, it seemed like it was almost like the end of your competitive career. You took a slam.
Yeah, I broke my collarbone opening weekend in Mammoth. Like first weekend I ever moved there, like riding the second day, I did like a front lip or something and like hooked my edge and like slammed really hard, like to the point where my collarbone almost like was pointing out of my skin. And It didn't quite pop through, but like had like this crazy bruise, like it was like right there. And I got surgery on that. And so that was like, kind of like I was in like a really crazy place as well, like just like getting off the New Zealand team and like moving to this new town and like not really knowing where I was going. But I had like a little bit of money because I had won the grant the year before at the Olympics. And so I had like a year's worth of like little bit of income coming in. So I had like a year to figure it out. And broke my collarbone, got surgery, and that's like, so I took like, it's not even like a crazy injury or anything, but it like kind of like shifted my perspective a little bit. And then I got cleared from the doctor 7 weeks later. And the day that I got cleared, I went back snowboarding and fell on my shoulder and re-broke my collarbone.
The same one.
Same one. Re-broke it. And I was like, refused to go to the hospital. I was like, it's not broken. It's just like, I just fell on it weird. Like it's not broken at all.
You're trying to let your mind
yeah,
fix it.
And I was like pulling my arm up and like I was like, no, nah, I wouldn't be able to do this if it wasn't broken. Like, why am I doing this right now? But and it didn't get better. So like 3 days later I went to the hospital and they were like, your collarbone is flat. Like the plate, because they put a plate in it, like had popped back up. So it was like pointing like this, and I had broken it in the lower, like originally broke it at the top, I broke it like down lower. And so they were like, you need surgery.
Do they have any sort of warranty on their surgery work that
shoulder
they did
warranty?
On it? You like buy one, get one free type no. of deal on the surgeries?
No, but I actually got kicked off my travel insurance. That's a whole other story. We can get into that. But yeah, so I had to get surgery again. So this was like a few days later. I like went back under and got surgery and was like, okay, I'm going to heal real good this time. And like healed up after that and was like feeling okay, but still like not 100% at all. And there was like a competition in Park City, actually a World Cup that was like maybe like a week after I should have even been snowboarding. So I was like, yeah, I'll go to that. And so I like registered for it and showed up to it. And like the night before the competition, I got a like an email, I think, from my travel insurance, And they were like, you've just had two surgeries. This is costing us so much money. We're kicking you off. And so my travel insurance kicked me off
for getting hurt too much.
And this was like the night before I was meant to compete. And I was like, shit, what do I do? Like, was like searching like travel insurance. Cause this is before the green card, I think. Yeah. I think it was before the green card.
Yeah. So you're not covered.
Yeah. Well,
you're out of New Zealand. Yeah. Basically.
So I would always just get travel insurance for like 6 months of the year, which was like probably way cheaper than actual insurance in America. But yeah, they kicked me off and I was like, didn't know what to do. I was like calling my mom up being like, what do I do? Like, I'm meant to be competing tomorrow. I'm already like half injured. Like, I shouldn't be competing at all. Haven't practiced at all. Like, didn't want to practice because I was like, I don't want to like risk falling. And I think I ended up like figuring out travel insurance the night before. I'm not sure if it even went into effect and for like 3 days later. But yeah, it was like, that was the last competition I ever competed in. And I got dead last. And yeah, that's how I ended my competitive career.
Good way to go out.
Yeah, good way to go out.
That's beautiful.
Funny how insurance has your back until you get hurt too much.
Yeah.
As long as you're paying and you're not getting hurt, everything's good.
Those fuckers have so much money, too. Yeah. You watch the Super Bowl, like the only companies that can afford to advertise, it's like all insurance companies.
Yeah.
Medication and insurance.
So I was talking to Scott and I was like, Steffi seems so chill. She's not stressed out ever. Like, does she ever stress out? And he's like, no, I've never seen her stress out. Which I think from a significant, like, I don't know any other male that, I mean, I'm speaking from a small pool, but most people wouldn't say that about their significant other. That's very uncommon. And then second of all, he goes, wait, there was one time she stressed out. And it was when she fucked her shoulder up right after she had just been cleared to snowboard. And she was refusing to accept that she was hurt. And that was the only time I've ever seen her stressed in my entire life.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really get stressed, to be honest. I don't see the point. Like, I feel like life complications are always, like, really minor most of the time. I mean, for what I've experienced anyway. So, like, yeah, I haven't really – I really try take every little moment and like just enjoy it because yeah, there's no point in like stressing over like the small stuff. Like, I'm very, very, very lucky in like my life as well and like what has been given to me. And yeah, I'm just like, I'm thankful. So yeah, I don't stress. I also run a lot, which is like definitely a de-stressor.
I'm taking notes here. I need a page out of her book. I drink this tea. It's called like stress free or something, and it doesn't work.
Yeah,
for me.
Go for a run. Honestly, running is great. But yeah, I feel like my parents are also like very mellow people. Like, they're just like they cruise through life, and I think that's where I got a lot of my mellow outlook on life from.
Makes sense. It makes sense. My dad is one of the most stressed out human beings on planet Earth. So now it's all coming.
It's all falling into line.
I think it might be that time for you know what, buds.
Name that video part.
All right, Steffi, how are we feeling today about name that video part?
Not feeling so good, you know. I might be the first person to not walk home with that chili bin, you know.
Oh, the chili bin. That's the cooler. Okay.
Isn't that what you give out?
Yeah, we give out a chili bin.
We give out a filled chili bin.
Damn.
Okay, so level of confidence 0 through 10. We'd like to do
a 0, straight up 0.
Love that.
Low expectations.
Yeah. All right, here we go. Here's the first one, or this is your song. Here we go.
The White Album, Shaun White.
That is correct.
Wow.
I love that soundtrack. That, honestly, that soundtrack was so good in that movie, and that's probably the only reason I actually got that. I still listen to it.
First of all, here's your chili bin.
Chili bin.
Filled with Bombhole merch.
Damn, thank you guys. It's a good looking chili bin.
Yeah, we got a Bombhole mug. I got some sweatpants in there.
Nice.
Figured you could use them, maybe some workouts. I don't know. You know,
they're very comfortable.
We got actually a Hannah Eddy shirt that sold out. I found an old one in there. That
Hannah Eddy did my logo for my business.
She did your logo? Let's give her. Actually, I'm not on the air horn soundboard. I would give her an air horn if I could right now.
She's the best.
So going back to the White Album, that was, I kind of got a little bit of cheater information because I was like, talk to Scott, and he's like, she knows the White Album. I haven't watched the White Album in like 10 plus years, and it is actually kind of fire. Sean White's video, by the way.
Yeah, the White Album is, I mean, it's got a really good soundtrack. Mm-hmm. And yeah, he's been up there at Woodward. We should watch it. I haven't watched that in years either.
He's at like Snow Park, New Zealand, doing like 40, 50 foot gaps to boxes. It's like the most unorthodox features ever, but
he's a crazy guy.
Yeah, ripping.
Ripping.
Okay, I actually still have one last name that video part for the listeners. You guys know the drill. Here we go. And that concludes this week's Name That Video Part. Let's talk Icon Pass. Now on sale, claim the best deals of the season before promos go away and prices go up on May 5th.
Own the season, own the stories, own the stoke.
For winter 21-22, unlock access to more than 40 Icon Pass destinations where you can explore wide open spaces. I personally like to explore Brighton Resort.
I like to check out Snowbird.
With exclusive spring savings and purchase options, including special pricing for 2021 pass holder renewals, and a payment plan from $0 down and 0% APR, your season of stoke is closer than ever. Explore pass options and take advantage of limited springtime offers before promos go away and prices go back up on May 5th. Let's talk about their options, buds.
The Icon Pass for $999, unlocking the most days, the most mountains, and no blackout dates. The Icon Base Pass for $729 opens up a season of adventure with limited blackout dates. And the Icon Session Pass 4-day for only $399 allows you to kickstart your ride.
As with last year, every Icon Pass comes with adventure assurance, including credits in the case of a COVID-19 closure, and the option to defer the value of an unused pass, no questions asked. Every moment spent in the mountains is a new opportunity for discovery and connection. Connection to the mountains and connection to each other.
Own the stoke today for the best prices of the season at iconpass.com.
So, a great friend of yours named Possum, I was talking with her a little bit to get some intel about yourself, and she just kind of queued me up with a key sentence, and it was left at Snapper Rocks. I don't know what that means. Can you explain to us that don't know what that means?
Yeah, I put my wetsuit on backwards once and went left at Snapper. Snapper's a right point break. And and you don't want to go left there, that's for sure. It's like a pretty like well-known break, you know? It's like pretty local-y, I feel like. But we went out with our friend Dingo. Not Dingo like the dingo, but
there's more
Australian dingoes. He's actually Australian. His name's Dean Morrison, and he's like an old school like professional surfer. He was like one of our really good friends, and he was like, oh yeah, let's go out to Snapper, like, and I was like, didn't know how to surf at all. Like, you have to like jump off the rocks to get out there. It was terrifying, and there was like all these jellyfish around. Like, I was having the worst time because you're like, I was like, I don't want to touch these jellyfish. And yeah, and Dingo was like, oh, we'll block like the waves for you guys, and you can go. And I was like, all right.
they block the other people, yeah, so you can get a wave.
Yeah, and they like blocked, and I was like, left.
And you're supposed to go right.
Yeah, it's like a right point break. Like, idiot.
It's hard reading the ocean at first.
Yeah, I mean, like, I don't know.
I'm more into just going straight.
Yeah, me too.
I just go straight. Me too. Yeah. I don't go left or right.
Yeah. Yeah, that was fun.
So you're out there, you got a backwards wetsuit, and you're going the wrong way on the point break. That's some kind of legendary shit.
Yeah, I turned the wetsuit around the other way, but it was kind of a mission. I had to do it on the beach. I, like, put it on, and I was like, this isn't right.
Hey, I got a Patreon question for you, since we're talking about New Zealand still.
Yep.
It's from Andy Gold.
Nice.
And he wants to know if you have any classic stories about Snow Park.
Oh, Snow Park. I was actually thinking about Snow Park yesterday when we're all up at Woodward.
Can you explain for listeners, too, what Snow Park is?
Snow Park? Yeah, Snow Park was like a one lift with like, it was like an all park hill, basically. It wasn't a mountain at all. It was a hill, and it was kind of run by like super young people. It was loose. There wasn't very many rules. Sam Lee and his family owned it, who were like these really, really awesome Kiwis. And they just like had the best outlook on like snowboarding and everything. And everyone would go there every summer from the States. And it was, yeah, there was like a perfect half pipe, like huge jump lines. And then like all the rails you can imagine ever, a perfect quarter pipe always at the bottom of the mountain and a hip. And yeah, it was just like this place that was like really, really, really awesome. And Woodward actually reminds me a lot about Snow Park. It had like the fast chairlift lap and just like all features everywhere, and like people were like linking up with one another, and just like, you know, like no matter what, you're going to like have a crew, even if you go up by yourself. And yeah, Snow Park was like, as soon as Snow Park was done, I stopped like wanting to go back to New Zealand for winters, because it was just such a good time there. They had like crazy parties always, and night riding, and like good food and coffee, and it was fun.
I remember the road to Snow Park. Is that the one that's crazy? It's like windy, yeah, and sketchy.
Yeah, the roads to all the mountains in New Zealand are sketchy and windy, but yeah, Snow Park Road was like well known for like car driving, like dirt car, like drifting and stuff. And there was actually like a really, really bad incident where this guy, Possum Bourne, I think his name was, and he had a statue up there. He like flew off the road and like ended up like passing away. Like it was like really, really sketchy road to like be drifting on. But we used to be so loose with driving up there when we were kids. We would like drift every corner.
Just because you saw people were drifting.
Yeah, I mean, it was like dirt roads and like perfect turns. Yeah. You could like drift no matter what.
I remember the photos coming out of Snow Park. There's always that classic shadow on the half pipe or whatever. It's still ingrained in my mind from photo annuals, yeah, back in the day.
Yeah, Snow Park was such a cool place for people. I remember like being up there, and like I remember it was like one of my first years snowboarding was like Ken Block was like hitting the jump in his car, and I was like, what is going on? I remember like Travis Rice filming up there, and like helicopters were up there like filming him in the park, like these helicopters that were so close to the resort, and that was like before drones and whatnot. But yeah, it was cool.
Another thing people don't think about too is when you go to New Zealand or Australia, it's their winter, but it's our summer. So I remember when we would go there, I would be like hammering beers all summer, and then you're like, okay, I'm going on a snowboard trip. And it was like, it always felt like a party when you go there.
Yeah, and especially because the drinking age is 18, I feel like, you know, if you go like when you're pretty young, you like let loose a little bit. But yeah, it's like definitely like more like vacation than snowboarding, I feel like, for most of the Americans that would go over there.
You're always received so well too. Everyone's so happy to see you.
Yeah. And I love it because like you're down in the town and you like travel to the mountain. So like you get like good weather down in town, and you can like skate in the afternoon and like even in the middle of winter, you know. So it's pretty cool. It's like it's nice.
You can skate, surf, and snowboard all in a day, huh?
Yep. Sure can.
That's pretty sweet.
So I think this might be a perfect time for our guest question. Guest question is presented by Solomon. Now, lately I've been riding the Solomon Taka split. That thing kicks ass. I know, Buds, you've been out on a Solomon split.
Dude, loving it.
Which one you were rocking?
Rocking the six-stick split. And, dude, for me, with all the equipment I have to bring up, it's life-changing how much faster you can get up the mountain compared to hiking, you know?
You don't have your board on your back.
It's, yeah, it's just so, well, it's just faster, yeah.
You got poles. You can point at shit.
Yeah, you can point at stuff and just get around better generally.
So our guest question is from Katie and Jill Perkins.
Uh-oh.
And it's a good one. Here we go.
Okay. Hey, Steffi.
Hey, Steffi. Jill and Katie here. You know, we were just chatting, and we came up with a question for you.
We always only see you with a couple bags whenever you travel. You pack pretty lightly, but you always seem super prepared. What are the top things that you never leave the house without?
You know, Katie and I might be able to help you out with this answer, Steffi. We do always see you with an orange Yeti sippy cup, and that must be top on your list. But if you could just fill us in on a couple other things that you definitely don't leave the house without, that would be phenomenal. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your time. So good. Thank you for your time.
I heard them like, Joe's away right now. I'm actually staying in her room. Thank you, Joe. But like giggling, I heard Katie giggling like down in the room last night with Jill, and I'm guessing it was because of this question. Traveling. Yeah, I don't like having like too much stuff when I'm traveling. Like I feel like I have like the minimum. But I always travel with my water bottle. I always travel with running shoes. Like I feel so lost without running shoes. Like I'm a huge runner, and even if I'm like, I like took them to Baker and it was like pouring rain, but I like, it just made me feel more comfortable. I always travel with ankle weights, a band, and a jump rope, because I like to work out, and on the road, that's all you really need, you know, like these just like really small things that are easy to travel with. And what else? I don't know. That's headphones. I always have headphones. But yeah, I like to pack light. I feel like Scott actually taught me that one. Like he has like crazy anxiety about like packing too much stuff and having too much stuff. And like we spend a lot of time in the back of his truck and like now in the van. And like having too much stuff is so unnecessary. You don't actually need it. So just bring what you need, and you know, you can always figure out the rest on the road.
I feel like it's the number one packing mistake is to overpack.
Yeah.
And I always do it first trip of the year.
Yeah.
You bring everything and then you're like, what is going on? I got too much stuff. And then you learn and then you just have a pair of jeans.
I feel like it could be a great time for some hot takes.
Hot takes. Let's do it.
First question for hot takes. Worst trend in snowboarding?
I would say those sideways jumps that slope style put in the middle of winter. Like I feel like those would make sense in spring, but not in winter, where like, I don't know, I feel like half the people are like slipping off those things without their edges. I feel like if they're going to put those in, like maybe make it in April.
Yeah, because you got to hit rails and then you got to hit but that also separates the people that can ride transition from the,
that's true,
the jumpers.
True, so. But I feel like in a sense, but like no matter what, like, you can slip out on those even if you can ride transition, you know?
That's a good point. next one, Michael Jordan of snowboarding. Who you got?
Palmer.
John Palmer? Great answer. Yeah. And now, for the second part of that, I was trying to figure out the female equivalent of Michael Jordan. I don't know, Lisa, yeah. Leslie, maybe? One of the
I'm not WNBA. Up on the female.
But anyway, who would you say NBA the Lisa players. Leslie of snowboarding is?
I feel like Jamie, honestly. But, like, if you want to go with, like, the Sean Palmer, like road, I'd feel like Jenna Mayan is pretty up there.
Great answers.
She's pretty punk rock.
I feel like
Palmer's
kind of the Rodman, almost.
Yeah, right? Yeah, he is the Rodman, for sure. Well, then who's the people's champ? We had a Instagram message saying we should ask who the people's champ is at snowboarding.
The people's champ.
I don't know. I feel like I don't know enough people to answer that.
My answer would be Lucas McGinn.
Lucas McGinn.
Yeah, that's true. Yep, Lucas is for sure the people's champ, no matter what.
Okay, what do you think about the edge drag in the parking lot when you're walking in the resort and you're dragging your board on the pavement?
Oh, I used to do that when I was way younger, thinking I was so cool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, nah.
Not back in it?
Not back in it. Just pick up your board.
Okay, what's your biggest fear?
Oh.
Hot take just turned a made a quick left right there. Huh?
Yeah, I don't know. Just I like it though. We're throwing curveballs in hot takes.
I like it.
Spiders?
I hate spiders.
Spiders are scary.
Yeah, and like anyone that like is pretty close with me knows that we live in like a little cabin and like around a bunch of trees, and and stuff, and we have a lot of spiders in our house, and I hate spiders. I like look under my sheets at night before I go to bed. Like,
isn't there some statistic where we swallow like a handful of spiders a year or something like that?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't. I heard maybe that's not true.
Oh really?
Let's go with that being fact check. Someone did a fact check.
How do you get that statistic? By the way, how are they getting that data?
That's the thing. How are they getting that statistic? And it would depend. I mean, where you live out in a cabin, who knows?
It's I'm like down. Way higher up. Probably. I probably eat like at least 2 spiders a week.
Utah's got tons of spiders.
I hate spiders. Poisonous ones. I'm getting like a little bit better with them, but.
What, do you like freak out when you see them? Like,
I like can't. I just like can't even touch them. I get like Scott to kill them usually, or put them outside. Usually kill them because I'm like, these spiders need to learn a lesson that to not come in the house right now.
You know, it's strange that there's pet guys. There's like you got snake guys, and then you got like spider guys. Mm-hmm. Like Levi, our buddy, is a skateboarder. He's got a pet tarantula.
Levi does. Actually, I've seen photos.
I don't know. I can't really wrap my head around being a spider guy.
You can't like cuddle up and watch TV with your spider.
Like, and if it gets like out, what happens if it gets out?
It's just out of there.
Who knows? You know, apparently he's got a special bond with the spider.
Really? Right here. Like it won't run away?
He thinks, I mean, I'm not trying to. I don't mean to, I don't know. It seems like it, like it's going to come back.
Yeah, it does. Like they know what's up.
I've only met one person in my life that's been more scared of spiders than me, and that's Pierre Whitberg.
Really?
Fun fact right there.
Fun fact right there. He is even more scared than I am, but he's like scared of like, sorry, Pierre, I'm putting you on the bus right now, but like bugs and everything. I remember being in Japan with him, and like there was like the stink bugs everywhere where we were staying, and like we were in like Niseko or something, and they were all over our house and like in everything, and those things don't really scare me, but I remember Pierre being like pretty freaked out of those things.
So you don't think you would do well in Joe Rogan's Fear Factor if there was a spider challenge?
Nah, but honestly, I feel like I should do it just to get over my fear.
Yeah, where you gotta put your arm in like a tank with 30 spiders.
Or like you lay in a coffin and they dump 200 tarantulas on you.
Yeah, I need
you would do it.
I need to do that to get over this.
We should set that up.
We'll insert the video if we end up finding 200 tarantulas in a coffin and we do this.
I mean, I think in LA you can just pay somebody like $50. They show up with 200. That's how they do it out there for shows like that.
I would. That's where I'd get stressed out for sure. Yeah, that's what I get stressed out.
We'll get you and Pierre. See who can win the challenge.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, we got one last curveball hot take. If you had $100 million in your bank account right now, what would be the first thing you'd buy?
A flight back to New Zealand. I feel like I can't get back home right now because of COVID. So, yeah, I want to go back there really badly.
What, they're crazy with COVID. They got shit figured out over there, right?
Yeah, they got shit figured out, but they've also got those borders pretty much locked up, so I can't go back home to visit my family.
I bet if you contracted a PJ, you could get over there.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what I would do, you know, like a little bit of money here and there, you know, pay the right people. I'm sure I could get in way easier than...
Dude, can we talk about how they handled the COVID situation? Because it seems like life is just normal.
Life is 100% normal for New Zealanders. Like, they're having, like, summer concerts, like, get-togethers, people. Like, no matter what, there's no such thing as masks. Well, actually, I think you have to wear a mask on, like, the airplane, but whatever. Jacinda Ardern, who's like the Prime Minister of New Zealand, definitely is like a leader to follow. She's doing some awesome stuff, and the like New Zealand like society actually like follows the rules to where they can get rid of COVID, and like the only cases that come in are through the border from people working at the border, and as soon as they come in and like someone's exposed to it, they like shut down the whole city, everyone goes in lockdown, and it's like that's how they take care of it, is just like these lockdowns, and people actually adhere to the rules and stuff, and yeah, they don't have COVID.
So you mentioned earlier your parents live in the Wop Wops, which is slang for middle of nowhere.
Yes.
So there's probably absolutely no like even threat of
absolutely anything. It's actually pretty cool, like knowing that my parents have like
0%.
Yeah, 0%, and even somewhat catching it. They live like the top of the South Island, like in like the Wairau Valley. It's like wine country basically, and like there's not even a supermarket where they live. There's like
a supermarket or a dairy?
there's not even a dairy, actually. There's not even a dairy. The closest city's like 30 minutes away, so it's not too far. But yeah, they live in the country and no such thing there. It probably doesn't even cross their mind day to day, to be honest. They don't have to remember to put a mask in their pocket when they go out to the dairy.
I saw a special on that where the prime minister just moved so fast.
Yeah.
Took all the precautions needed, like, without even hesitating.
Yeah.
And just did all the right moves.
And, yeah.
And it worked. And
yeah, she's...
And everyone listened to her was the big part. You don't have your anti-maskers. And
yeah, exactly. I feel like New Zealand is such a smaller... I mean, it's just a tiny population, so, like, it's a kind of a little bit easier to follow the rules and, like, I don't know, yeah, just smaller population, so easier to get rid of COVID. And
she didn't hesitate, though. I think that was the biggest move that she did properly.
She didn't hesitate, and she still doesn't hesitate to this day. Like, as soon as something comes in, it's, like, shut down immediately and get rid of it before anyone can be exposed.
Smart.
Yeah.
And it worked.
Yep. Especially in, like, Auckland is where it's the only city it really comes into. And like, yeah, you don't want the older generation, like, getting it there, you know. Like, it could spread so fast on a small island like that. So, yeah, it's pretty cool to see how she's dealing with it.
So they had zero deaths then?
No, they had it, like, in the midst of it. But they had some deaths, but it was small. It was like, I feel like it was like under 200 people or something. But yeah, I don't know. I need to look that one up.
Fact checked on that.
Yeah.
Listen, we need to talk about Wild Mics. The fact is, they are a sponsor, and you signed a contract guaranteeing them certain concessions. One of them being spot on the show.
Well, that's where I see things just a little differently. Contract or no, I will not bow to any sponsor.
I'm sorry you feel that way, but basically, it's the nature of the beast.
Maybe I'm wrong on this one, but for me, the beast doesn't include selling out. Stony, you know what I'm talking about, right?
It's like, people only do things because they get paid. And that's just really sad.
I can't talk about it anymore. It's giving me a headache. Here.
Drink one of these.
The Bomb Hole. Banter. Edgy. Cheddar biscuits.
Look, you can stay here in the big leagues and play by their rules, or you can go back to the farm club. It's your choice.
Yes. And it's the choice of a bomb hole generation.
So whenever I've been out shooting with you, Desiree, last time we were hanging out, I think I had just gotten food poisoning or something. And Desiree was like, Steffi's never been sick. You need to eat more like her. And so are you like super healthy or...
I care a lot about my health, I guess. I wouldn't say I'm like super healthy. I don't have like a strict diet or anything. I'm a true believer of like listening to my body with like nutrition and going with the seasons and eating with seasons and health and like fitness stuff has been like a huge part of my life for forever. I've always been really into it, so it's been cool to like start up a business. Actually, I've got like an online personal training business where I like have online clients and I train them via the World Wide Web. And yeah, it's really cool to like be helping people from afar and, you know, keeping people's motivation up. And yeah, it's really fun. I love it. And that's the whole other side of my life that is actually a huge portion of it.
What's your business?
It's Steffi, but Steffi Fitness is what it's called. And yeah, it's like I do like classes in Mammoth in the summer, but because I travel so much, it's not like super consistent. But yeah, it's online personal training platform where I like work pretty closely with like individuals and like I'll be like texting them the morning of the workout and like I update workouts 3 times a week. It's like 3 times a week worth of workouts where I'll be working closely with you, and each workout is different. Like, I change the workout up each time, so it's not super repetitive. Like, a lot of the exercises are the same, but like the actual workout's different. And like gradually building as people get stronger and stronger, and it's been like a really cool thing to figure out. I have no idea what I'm doing with business stuff. I don't have a business plan or anything, but I'm just kind of like taking it day by day and going from there.
And you do you help them with their diet and everything too?
I don't actually do too much about diet because I don't have like a crazy education on that.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like diet and like nutrition and stuff is such an individual thing to work out as well. Like, I like eat by listening to my body, and like I don't really like eating out. I like cook pretty much most of my meals. I would eat out like on occasion, but really not that much at all. And but yeah, I don't do too much with like nutrition. Like, if people ask me questions, like my clients ask me questions, I will 100% respond with my opinion. But yeah, I don't do too much work with
you. More so, just eat what feels good.
Yeah,
dairy
exactly.
Makes you sick. You're not eating any dairy,
and I like,
you like to know what's in your food.
And like, I don't really eat meat in America because I don't 100% trust it, to be honest. But like, say if I'm in New Zealand and like my parents bought like a cow from the neighbor that they slaughtered, like I'll eat that because I know it's like raised on grass and
no antibiotics.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't realize how if you've never traveled from America, when you go to these different countries, like the eggs are a different color, the meats are a different color.
Yeah.
And it's not because their stuff's weird. It's because our stuff's weird.
Yeah. Like, coming to America, it was like pretty culture shock with like the food side of things, just with everything. And like, and I do notice like my body adjusting, like going back to New Zealand and eating like more clean, like less like antibiotics and all that, and like sprays and pesticides and all that kind of stuff that are on the vegetables, you don't notice it so much in a day-to-day life, but like moving back, like going back to New Zealand, you notice like your body adjusting to it again.
You're like, having more energy and stuff like that, is what you're saying?
Yeah, like more energy, and like and then like if you've been eating like really clean in New Zealand and coming back to America, like you can be like so
weighs you down or something.
Yeah, like so tired and like sore stomachs and whatnot. But
going back to Stefi Fitness, I think it's really cool too. I can only speak for personal experience, but you know, when you have somebody like yourself, if you're writing personalized workouts and you're kind of have people that you're working with, it's you need somebody to hold you accountable, I feel like. And that, I shouldn't say you. I should say I need somebody to hold me accountable. And if I'm like, people are like, oh, I'll do it on my own. It's like, it's fucking invest in your body, you know? It's like funny how people be like, well, I'm not going to pay $20 to go to a fitness class, like, but they have no problem spending $80 at the bar.
Yeah.
Why do our minds work like that? You know, it's an interesting deal.
Yeah. And that's what I wanted to do with my side of things, is like being able to work closely with people and like keep their motivation, because it's so hard, like fitness and like being motivated, it's so hard to like stay motivated, especially with like our lifestyles of snowboarding and stuff. And I just like, instead of just having like some app or something, I want to like have like myself there working with the person, like keeping them motivated, and which is like how I'm doing it differently to say like Peloton app or like any of these apps. You know, it might not be like as high a quality, but it's like you've got like the personal interaction.
Is it live when you do it?
No.
Or do you pre-record?
No. It's like how I do it is like, it's like a sheet basically, and I update the sheet every I update it Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday night, and then I like will like text or email someone in the morning, like reminding them that they have their workout, and then I always get them to, I've got like 8 clients right now, and so I always get them to like message me when they get it done, and like,
yeah.
And if they don't message me, I'm like, did you get your workout done today?
See, accountability, like Chris is talking
about.
Yeah,
exactly, and like I also like understand that people's lives are like crazy, so if they can't get the workout done that day, like I'm like, no worries, I'll keep it up for like Friday, and you can get your next one done on Sunday, or you can take a day off this week, you know.
If they ghost you, you know they didn't do it.
Yeah.
And then you keep on them, and then they do it, and they thank you.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, the fitness stuff is crazy. Like, there's like there's like four stages of fitness, and it's like pre-contemplation, contemplation, action, and maintenance, I think. And like, I see so much in my fitness, like business, as like people get to like month three and then they kind of get off track, and it's like all you really need is like three more months to like somewhat make it a routine and make it like almost addictive. Like, because once you get to the 6 month mark, is like it like becomes like a habit basically. And like, and yeah, it's like I've noticed a lot of people like kind of like going like really, really motivated, and then month three, and then like kind of losing motivation again. And yeah, I'm just like really going to work hard on like keeping it a habit for people to keep working out, and like especially like snowboarders in the winter, because I feel like a big chunk of snowboarders are good at fitness and working out and stuff pre-season, but like come winter, it's like snowboarding's their fitness. But I also think it's so important to like maintain that fitness throughout the winter, and yeah, so I constantly work out through the winter no matter what. I don't switch it up at all. I keep it the same. I make the workouts like higher intensity in the summer, but yeah, I work out 3 times a week, and like I try run like 20 miles a week along with snowboarding as well, just to like, it's not necessarily for my snowboarding, but it's more for my brain than anything. But yeah, it's like important to keep on track no matter what the season is.
So how do you break down your mileage for running usually?
So I go by feel. Like if I'm like running, I'm super not into it, I just go home because I don't see the point in running. But yeah, I like to like have like a 20 mile base and then like go run, like chip away at that throughout the week. And so like, so say on Monday I'll run 5 miles, and then like, you know, Tuesday I'll run 3 miles, and then I mean I don't always get to 20 miles. It's more so in the summer, but like, yeah, I like to just have that in the back of my mind, and like it's kind of a nice like motivating goal to have. Mm-hmm. And yeah, running's like my meditation. Like I love running so much, and I've been addicted to it forever, and like it's like how I like decompress and like think and have like a clear mind if I'm like studying and whatnot.
Now, keeps you zen, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for people that, I don't know how to meditate, but.
Yeah, neither yeah, it's, do I. It's kind of like, so I just form. Run.
Yeah. So going back to that, if you're, a lot of our audience is boarders, you know?
Yeah.
What would you say that you know, if you're going to give three pieces of advice to like, you know, maybe workouts that boarders could do, do you have any? Like workout type stuff you recommend?
Yeah, I would say like during the winter, core strength is super important. Core, like your core strength will keep like your body balanced basically. So like injury prevention, it's like a lot of like fitness stuff comes from the core, and like no matter, like even if you're doing squats, you know, you're going to be engaging your core, and like, so keeping that strong, because you don't necessarily want to be doing like leg workouts if you're you're gonna have like a big day snowboarding the next day and whatnot. So, yeah, I think core strength is really important. What else? Like band work. Like I always travel with bands, and it's like small exercises that can be like you can be doing in front of the TV or whatever. And I think that they're really, really good ways of like keeping injury prevention down, like it's mm-hmm. a good injury prevention like mm-hmm. activity skill or whatever. And then the third one is like I think having a solid cardio like base as well is really good. Like you don't necessarily have to go for a run, but like a 30-minute walk or like a few times a week, it's like it's important to keep up the cardio for snowboarding too.
Yeah, going back to this type of stuff, it's funny for a lot of people, you know, myself, I like bro workouts.
Yeah.
Like, I like, but ultimately, you know, you'd listen to Tom Brady, his whole shit is pliability. Because why do you need pliability? So I'm a quarterback, I'm getting destroyed.
Yeah.
And what are snowboarders? Like, I think I lift weights, but really I probably should be doing band work, because really you need to be able to take a slam, and like being able to squat something isn't going to maybe help me take a slam. Like if you're working with bands and flexibility, your body is more absorbing impact.
Yeah.
What do you think about that stuff?
Yeah, I agree. But like I said, like all the workout stuff that I do, I like do not relate to snowboarding at all, mm-hmm. which is like kind of crazy. I don't know. I feel like also like if you find something and you enjoy it, like do it, because mm-hmm. no matter what, like this exercising is so good for you. It's like, it's so good for like, obviously like physically, but like mentally as well. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I think like if you're into the bro workouts, then like just keep going at them, because no matter what, you're like bettering yourself.
Since you know a lot about this stuff, do you prescribe your clients roids by chance? You know?
Yeah, yeah. No matter what, everyone's on the roids.
You get them all on the
mandatory.
Roids. Mandatory roids.
Yeah, mandatory roids. Stefi Fitness.
What do you think about? Like, I'm just asking for a friend because I definitely like, but just like
not himself.
What do you think about just like chugging creatine on a regular basis?
I mean, go for it. Like, if do
Are
what you want.
Are people still doing creatine?
I don't know, but it's just fun to talk about it.
Yeah. You know, whatever you're into, I guess.
It makes weightlifters bigger, right?
I don't actually know a lot about it, to be honest, but it just seems like the most bro thing below steroids you can take.
Like creatine,
do you
bro.
Think? Do you think that would even help you snowboarding, though? I feel like your muscles would like get in the
way. Yeah, I think it more big builds those big weird muscles. Yeah, that aren't actually,
you would like
that
not
beneficial.
You'd like not be able to grab or something.
I like that. We talk about it on here a lot, but I would love to see mandatory steroids in competitive snowboarding, and every rider kind of like. Just looks kind of like Schwarzenegger Jacked. In his prime, and they are just like walking around and Gold's Gym style, you know, tank tops.
Yeah, who would pull that off the best?
An outerwear tank top?
If I had to, I feel like Chris Corning probably could pull that one off pretty good.
Yeah.
I don't know him well, but
yeah,
it seems like.
I don't really know that guy, but
if I'm gonna
go, Chris.
If I'm going to be a judgmental person of judging somebody I don't know, I'd say he could maybe fit that one.
Yeah.
So just to be clear, you do prescribe roids to your...
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Yep, straight up.
So if you guys are looking for personal fitness, at Stefi Fitness on Instagram, correct?
Yep. Yeah. Or you can email me, stefiluxtonfitness@gmail.com.
Boom.
Plug.
We got some new... we got a new sponsor, board sponsor going on, correct?
Yeah. I just jumped on the Arbor boards this year. I don't know how to say that. And I got to put my American
accent. The Kiwis drop the R.
Arbor.
Arbor.
I'm riding my Arbor snowboards.
Yeah, what are you rocking here?
This is the Swoon. This is the Swoon. This is my power board. It's a 151, which is actually a little bit small, but it feels like it rides a little bigger than a 151, to be honest, but I've been really liking this board this year. It's really fun for like jumping in the backcountry. I've been trying to like hit more jumps in the backcountry this year, and like it's a little stiffer, so you can land like a little bit better. And yeah,
regular camber.
It's regular camber. Yep, mm-hmm. yep.
Yeah, Scott said that you did an incredible back seven on that thing recently, and he had to watch the clip like 15 times. So apparently, the Swoon is working.
Swoon's good at jumps. I'll give you that.
What do you do to your board? Anything particular edgewise?
Nothing.
Take it out of the plastic, slap it on the
yeah,
snow?
Yeah, I actually don't think I've ever even waxed this thing this year. Yeah, there's no wax on it. I don't wax my board. That's what I do.
Do you recommend that technique? Or?
I feel like you can do the non-wax thing for like to a certain point, and then like past that point, maybe you need wax. But
it depends on a brand's factory wax program,
yeah.
too. Huh?
Yeah, the
Arbor's pretty good.
Yeah,
huh?
Their factory wax is so fast. I remember, like earlier on in the season, I got onto Marie's board, and I was like, "This is the fastest board I've ever ridden in my life." Probably haven't waxed that one ever either. Keep it that way. I don't know. I don't do much to my boards. I don't like to think about it too much.
She keeps it simple.
I used to be a crazy head case when it came to snowboarding, though. I remember I would hate new things, and like I would ride a board until it was like donezo. Like I hated new boards. And I remember right the morning of the Olympics, or the night before the Olympics, one of the coaches at the Olympics was like, your board's broken, like you can't ride this thing. And the jumps were pretty big, and so you needed like a bit of speed to like get over them. And I remember them like testing snow on like my broken board versus like I had a new board as well. And like the snow like moved so fast on the new one, and it was just like putting down on the on the broken
almost
one,
almost not moving.
And they're like, "You need to change it tonight." Like, and I was like, "Damn it, I really don't want to." Like, I really didn't want to ride a new snowboard. So, but I ended up like changing it and like woke up early the morning of the Olympics and like went to the top of the mountain, which was really cool. Actually, those mountains in Russia are beautiful, and like trying to get used to it and. It really didn't even matter. Like, it's all in your brain. Like,
a new board's tough, though. Yeah. Right?
I think I did actually hook my edge on one of the practice runs. And like, I ate shit before the comp, but.
Sharp, fresh edges.
Yeah.
Now, this swoon, it looks like it has like a spoon shape, maybe?
Yeah.
Is that just the lighting?
The edges? No, right on the contact points look like they ramp up.
That looks pretty cool.
They call these, this is Grip Tech. Don't know.
It's a good plug. She knows her tech.
It says it right here on the edge.
She just saw it.
Grip Tech works great.
Grip Tech is working. Yeah, it looks pretty cool the way I imagine that's ripping in the powder.
Yeah.
Because your contact points look like they spoon out a little bit.
Yeah. I really like it. And I've been loving this board, honestly. It's really fun. I'm very thankful for Arbor and them supporting me.
Dope.
Well, I got one last guest question here. And this is from Melissa Rotano. Here we go.
Hey guys, Melissa here. I'm really excited that you have Stefi in the booth today. I'm excited to hear this story that we've been talking about for the past couple days now, and for you to share with everybody of how you were arrested. It's pretty funny thinking of this sweet angel just being arrested, so I can't wait to hear it.
What kind of cop would arrest you?
Well, I was 15 when I got arrested. And I, do you remember who, do you remember Ellery Hollingsworth?
Yes. I do, yeah.
She was like a burden rider, super young burden rider, and then like moved to Nike. And she was like one of the first people I met, like one of the first American people I met. I met her when I was 14. And because I was skating at the skate park at the time. And there was like no females that were skating, and I remember like her coming and like ripping at like skating, and I was like, I want to be this girl's friend, and like became friends with her instantly, and we like had a good time, and there was like the Burden New Zealand Open was on, and she was competing in it, and like had like keep competing all week. The week she was there, like I'd known her for like a year at this point, and there was like an after party that night at the bars in New Zealand. And she was like, I have this fake ID. You can use it. I'll use it first and I'll pass it to you. And I was like in the back of the line. And I was like, perfect. Like, that's going to work out awesome. And I grew up in Wanaka. And so like, this is a tiny town. Like, it's not big at all. Like, it's way bigger these days than what it was back then. And so she passed me the fake ID, and like, she got in fine, passed it to me, and then I got in fine, and we were like hanging out at the bar, and like, you know, everyone that was like competing that week was there. And I remember all of a sudden I like get this like tap on my shoulder, and I was like, oh shit, and like turn around, and it was this this lady whose daughter her daughter was in my class in high school, and this lady for some reason like hated me my whole entire life. She like she just hate, like, I don't even know what I did, or maybe I didn't do anything. I don't know. She just like had this freaking sour taste about me or whatever. And she was like, she like wrenched my shoulder and was like, "What are you doing in the bar? How did you get in here?" And I was like 15, and I was like, I hadn't even really been drinking, and maybe had like one drink or something. And I like freak out, and I like, I don't know what to do. And she was like, "Show me how you got in here." And like, I like automatically like went to Ellery, because that's how I got in, which I shouldn't have done. It was so dumb of me. And I was like, "Ellery, we gotta go. Like, I'm in trouble right now." And she, and Ellery, and we're like walking out, like the bouncers like are taking us out of this bar, and Ellery like refuses to admit that she knows me, because she didn't want to leave. And she's like, who is this girl? Like, she's like, I don't know who this is. Like, yada, yada. And I was like, Ellery, just say, just let's just go. Like, they're like, if you keep arguing, they're going to call the cops. And she like kept, she like refused to
admit. She went back down.
She wouldn't back down. She wanted to keep partying. Like, fair enough. And so they ended up calling the cops, and me and Ellery got arrested, taken to the cop station, and like got fined. And I remember, like, I was like, my snowboard career is over before it's even started, because she was like staying with like the Burden team, and I was like, the Burden team's gonna hate me. And she was so pissed off at me for years and years. Like,
you kind of narked.
I straight up narked. Yeah. Like,
that's kind of a bad look out there in the streets.
I know. I'm gonna go ahead and say like, that. And like, I remember like talking to Spencer O'Brien about it, and she's like, it makes so much sense that it was you that got Ellery arrested, because like, you tell the truth, you know. And I was like, yeah, I guess I didn't know what to do at the time, and I was so distraught the next day. I remember I like didn't know what to do. Ellery wasn't like, I was like trying to apologize to Ellery, but she wasn't getting back to me. And so they were staying like at these apartments across the lake, and they were like little like townhome apartments, not like a hotel, but kind of. And I went and knocked on every single one of those apartment doors to like go and apologize to Ellery, because I was like, I had to say sorry. Like, I felt so bad. And I like went and got money out of my bank to like pay her fine. It was like $300. And I like was working at like friggin' the deli at the supermarket or something at the time. And so I like got all my money out of my bank and like put it in my pocket and like knocked on all these apartment doors just to go apologize to her and like offer her this money. And like eventually found her, and she like somewhat accepted the apology. Well, it was pretty.
She took the money.
She didn't even take the money. No, she didn't accept the money, but she was pretty pissed at me for the next few years. And I still feel bad to this day for knocking on her. I'm very sorry, Ellery.
She held a grudge. Yeah. Like, you'd see her later, a year later. And
yeah. And she was still like, yeah, fuck
you. She'd be like, that chick's a narc, man.
Yeah. But yeah, that was pretty funny. Yeah. Arrested at 15, and it was the cops called my parents. I was like living at my parents' house, obviously. I was 15, and they were like, we can't come pick you up. We've had a couple of drinks, like we can't even like come get
your
you
parents.
From- They're like, sorry.
They're out in the countryside. Yeah.
And so the cops had to drive me home. It was.
What's a nice place? Because in the States, they would have just locked you up overnight.
Yeah.
It's nice. They would drive you out to what's it called? The
Wop Wops.
The Wop Wops. They'd bring you out to the Wop Wops, drop you off.
Yeah.
But in the States, you'd be sleeping in the clink.
Yep. I think it could be time for a little pub beer action.
All right. Let's get into our breakout moment presented by our friends over at 10 Barrel and Pub Beer. Pub Beer supports us. You should support them. Their tagline is cheap, fun beer. Now, Steffi, before snowboarding became a serious career, back when it was cheap and fun, do you have a memorable breakout moment?
First of all, I don't think snowboarding's a serious career. I feel like it's more of like, I don't know, whatever, a lifestyle. But honestly, breakout moment, I feel like I haven't had one yet. Still waiting.
We're in the middle of it. It's happening right now.
Yeah, I'm about to turn 30. Maybe I'm about to peak. You know, women peak in their 30s. Apparently,
that's great. That's a great answer, and I think you're right. It is more of a lifestyle.
Yeah, not so serious.
And Steffi Fitness is about to be booming.
Yeah, booming.
I might have to hire someone.
And before, I think we kind of have been doing it. And do you have any thank yous you want to throw out there?
Thank you to my family. My family are like my biggest supporters ever. I feel like they don't really even understand what I'm doing still, but they're always there supporting me. And like my mom and my dad and my brothers and all my extended family are like the best people ever. And I miss them so much. And yeah, I guess thank you to them, and thank you to everyone and snowboarding and sponsors and whatnot, but thank you, you guys. Yeah,
it's got to be tough being far away from them like that during these times. Yeah, where it's hard to travel.
Yeah, it's really tough, but I mean, eventually we'll get out of it and be able to like keep on keeping on.
So. Yeah, hopefully soon, right?
Yeah, hopefully soon.
All right, Steffi. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. We really appreciate having you. It's been a pleasure chatting, and all the New Zealand slang especially.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a good time learning that.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me. It's been a fun one. Sparking up some memories for sure.
Well, beautiful. We want to thank you guys for listening and tuning in each week. We will see you again next Wednesday. Over and out from the Bomb Hole.